council is charged with reviewing, considering, discussing, debating, and advocating on such issues and matters affecting local government and Whitestown community that the members of the youth council and the Whitestown community have determined to be important and appropriate, and which are for the betterment of Whitestown and its youth. The youth council is encouraged to identify issues affecting Whitestown youth that should be considered by local government, seek and develop realistic and efficient solutions, and make recommendations for consideration by the town council. The youth council shall report to the town council on its activities at least 3 times each term. 7, effective date. This ordinance shall be in full force and effect from and after its passage adopted by the town council of Whitestown. Mr. President, I would make a motion and move suspend the rules and have second reading of ordinance 2016-21 this evening.
Second.
All right, we got a motion that's been seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Rules are suspended.
Second reading, ordinance 2016-21, an ordinance of the town council of the town of Whitestown, Indiana, creating a council. Mr. President, I make a motion to adopt ordinance 2016-21.
Second.
All right, we have a motion that's been seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. Ordinance is adopted, 4-0. Moving on to letter D under new business, we have ordinance 2016-22 in front of us, which is a ordinance to create a neighborhood council. That's one.
I will, just a little bit of history. I sat on the Kona in Bloomington as the president of one of the neighborhood associations there. It worked very well. And the reason for this would be that it's really the unity of all of the neighborhoods as one Whitestown community. So you hear many times, where do you live? Well, I live in Walker Farms. Where do you live? I live in Eagles Nest. But for the Whitestown to be first, the neighborhood to be second. So what this does is it takes representatives from each of our subdivisions, puts them on one council to have one single voice to the town council. And what this is neighborhood council would do basically is talk about things that are things that have equal significance across the board in any neighborhood that we have. Pools, streets, the sidewalks, the ADA ramps, the signage, lighting, speeders to neighborhoods. I can go down the list of things that I have to deal with on a daily basis that I get from Facebook a lot. So what this would do is basically take all of those items, not necessarily away from staff, but staff will still be paying attention to dealing with those, put them into a council which will then directly communicate with the town council via even resolutions from this council on things that are important to the neighborhoods as a whole. Now, some neighborhoods will have different issues than others. Some neighborhoods' needs will be different than others. Some neighborhoods' priorities will be different than others. But I think what you're going to find out is that the majority of the issues that the neighborhoods are dealing with are very much the same. So this council does two things. Unifies the neighborhoods, number one, and gives our citizens yet another opportunity to sit on a ordained body where they can discuss issues, pass resolutions, and pass those on as direct communication to the
I think one of the positives of this ordinance that this commission presented is that with those Facebook groups that you're talking about, the really closed group you have to petition access for. And oftentimes those neighborhood groups aren't seeing each other's pages, not seeing the conversations going on. This gives them an opportunity to gather together, face to face, person to person, discuss some of the issues and find out just how similar some of the things they're dealing with are, so they can come to a common resolution, create a resolution, and then resolve to talk to us about it. So I think that's a great opportunity, a good way to move forward. So this is a very positive step, I believe.
There are also some residents in some of our neighborhoods who have not necessarily identity crisis. They really don't know where they are. Some of that has been via the postal address issues that we have, postal districts that are chopped up in town. I know that Park Meadows has been very when we talk with them via Facebook, there's a lot of people that say, I didn't even know that I was in Whitestown. They learn that now. They learn that we're very responsive. It's been very good communicating. And this will just help for them to understand, oh yeah, we are a nice town, we're involved in our own town government, we're excited about that, we'll communicate with our town government directly.
We're also identifying several neighborhoods on here that are newly established, such as Maple Grove and the Grove by Watermark and Redwood. These are places that even didn't exist a couple of years ago, whereas Waterfront and Lakeson Ford and even Clark Dudley has been around for several years. So I think this is very positive to bring on here. So thank you, Mr. Dudley, for bringing this forward.
I do want to point out that I think we forgot to probably add in rural
We did.
Rules are suspended.
Ordinance 2016-22, an ordinance established. adoption of ordinance 2016-22.
Second.
All right, we have a motion, it's been seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Ordinance is adopted 4-0. All right, moving on to letter E. Ordinance 2016-23, an ordinance adopting internal control standards and procedures. I will let Councilman Long do the first read and any explanation.
So I'm going to read by first, ordinance 2016-23, an ordinance adopting internal control standards and procedures. This council, a couple months ago, passed a resolution tasking myself, clerk treasurer, and town manager with complying with new sections of Indiana code requiring that after 6:30 of this year, we would have internal control standards. After doing research and investigation, having meetings between myself and clerk treasurer, myself and town manager, with their meetings thereafter, we came to the agreement that by adopting the standards laid out by the State Board of Accounts, and by the town manager presenting the training by the State Board of Accounts, we would be in compliance with the code. Additionally, we have discussed that the standards for State Board of Accounts are written as one size fits all, and we are not a one size fits all community. And so the town manager and the clerk treasurer will be continuing to work with different departments to figure out what our internal policies and procedures will be to implement these standards, and that they will then keep written copies of those standards to State Board of Accounts and come in on us for those. With the way that this is worded, we'll adopt the standards that are required by State Board of Accounts and allow the flexibility for staff to document their procedures and change them as necessary to remain in compliance without having to come back before this council to get those approvals. And so that is what the town manager, clerk treasurer, and I have brought to you for adoption tonight in compliance with the code 15 days early. Resolution number 2016-29, a resolution adopting a procurement card policy for town of
All right, we have a motion that's been seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say no. Resolution is adopted 4-0.
Good job on that, Mr. Director.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Next up, we have letter H, resolution 2016-30.
Oh, boy. Sorry.
Go ahead, Mr. Chair. Yes, you go to the floor.
We're doing very well. I can't help but love my trash projects at this point. Anybody that drives to Interstate sees that there are buildings going up right and left. One of those buildings was built for the builder's spec, and now we have a proposed tenant. A tenant is a Fortune 100 company. Ben from the EDC is here tonight. He did a very good job of communicating with me and our staff on this project, and then I communicated with the council. I'm very excited about the project. Which is my background. I think this is one of those that fits very well for the town. It is distribution, but the wages are much higher than your typical distribution wage. I think that's because of the nature of the company and what they're dealing with. And the fact that they're taking space in one of those buildings that's going up tells the market, you build a white tent, you're going to fill a white tent. And they're asking for a standard 10-year tax deduction. Personal property. The personal property is quite an extensive investment of around $26 million. You don't see that very often either. It's Amazon-ish in the investment. So I would recommend, as your economic development staff as well, I recommend that you approve this request for tax deduction for this very good company, which to be calling Whitestown.
This will take up the entirety of
the
spec building,
is that correct? No, it will. It will take up this whole building.
And how much more inventory will we have
building 19 is going up, and we'll have about 100, if I remember right, around 110,000 square feet left after Telemon goes in. Mm-hmm. I know that Lauren has been approached by, I think she's been approached by Duke, and they're talking about putting building 8A up into the air, which is quite extensive. GDI Construction is talking about a 700,000 to 1 million square foot. Maybe lose the whole room. Square foot facility. Bent now continues to put buildings up in Perry Industrial Park. I believe they're scheduled for one or not two more soon in the Whitestown Industrial Park, which is on the, I guess it'd be the north side of 267, the kind of the northwest-ish side of 267 at that point. That potentially could have 1.7 million square feet of building. That's all been approved. Development plans has been approved. They're talking about going vertical very soon as well. We're talking to some really good companies right now as well. And then his staff are talking, they're doing the same. So we're in a really hot period. Based on what you get tonight. Hence the title and the sentence.
So there's a lot of big buildings going in, and maybe this is on top of it. What about small buildings?
Well, Molly and I are talking about small buildings. As we get south, we in our comprehensive plan, we basically said we don't want any more big box buildings as we go south. The thing though is the towns don't build buildings. We're not in the market of being landlords, so the people that do build buildings and have the capital to do so, obviously are still seeing in the market the 200,000 to 700,000 building is a good return on investment for them. So it's really hard to convince somebody who's making a lot of money on the product that they're putting up to put a different product up now. But that being said, I think that we will start to see some 50,000, 25,000 square foot buildings that Molly and I have talked about. Molly White at the EDC, and she and I have had a really good long sit-down conversation about the I-65 corridor between Indianapolis Road and I-65 becoming what we call a graduate park. Everybody wants a launch. We need to do a launch thing as well. Everybody wants an incubator, but those companies have nowhere to go when they're not incubating. So you can be a ZWorks all you want to, but when you find you're a public and you have to have 25,000 square feet, you have nowhere to go to the Dallas Metro. Nowhere. But what I said is, let's Whitestown be that place. If you're ready to grow to second stage or even first stage out of the closet, this is the place that you can go because we have the buildings to do it. So we're looking for a business partner right now, looking for a development partner that will go into the town and public-private partnership to build what you would call the graduate apartment, to have those 10,000 square feet to 50,000 square foot glass front buildings that face the interstate that would fill the niche in that property. For now, it's not being built because we're filling big buildings. Good question.
Resolution 2016-29, a resolution of the Town Council of the Town of Whitestown, Indiana, approving personal property tax deduction in Whitestown, DRA number 1, under Indiana Code 6-1.1-12.1. Mr. President, I move adoption of resolution 2016-30.
Second.
All right, we have a motion and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Say aye. All those opposed say no. Resolution's adopted 4-0.
This must be a cast.
Yeah, I'm a little scared.
I'm sure we're advertising.
Up next is letter I, resolution 2016-31.
Resolution 2016-31, a resolution concerning policy for submitting formal records requests and other legal process on behalf of Whitestown.
Dennis Anderson, to fill a staff board.
Counsel.
Chief, I know you had, we had some emails calling back and forth today, but I didn't see all those, so we can update us.
As most of you are aware, on April 28th, we lost Sergeant Valbo to a serious medical condition that currently has him hospitalized. It's a syndrome called Guillain-Barré. It has an effect on the body where it basically takes over and causes total paralysis. The day he, Sergeant Valbo worked the day before, on that night out of bed to get up the next morning, stepped out of bed and felt flat on his face. By the time he was transported to the hospital, by mid-afternoon, we were notified he was paralyzed, basically from the shoulders down. That has been a roller coaster ride for him since being admitted into the hospital. He has since undergone a number of different procedures. There's no known cure for this. It's a virus that the body has that takes antibodies in the blood and programs them to attack bad cells like the flu and things along those lines. And when the body fights off the infection, it doesn't know to stop telling the antibodies to continue to attack, so it starts to attack the nerves. He's showing some great progress. I visited with him yesterday. I try to get down and see him about every other day. He has movement back in his right arm. He can lift it above his head. He's got movement back into his right hand. He can hold large objects. He doesn't have the motor functions yet to do small things. Jeanette and I took him a bag of M&Ms at his request, and he was able to, if I could put them in his hand, he could actually feed himself, which is a huge step forward from just 2 days prior. He has since today has been up on the side of his bed, going through about 30 minutes of rehabilitation, starting to see some tremors in his lower extremities and also into his left hand. If you've read anything about this syndrome, it's literally all over the place as far as how it affects the human body and the recovery rate and the recovery percentages. It can be anywhere from 6 months to 7 years of recovery. It can be anywhere from 50% recovery of all motor functions to the high 90s, and just anywhere in between. There's no rhyme or reason to how people recover from this syndrome. So needless to say, it's left a huge void in our hearts. It's left a huge void in our staff. And so we started the process. We've got all of his paperwork done to get him onto the short-term and long-term disability. And exactly what that's going to play out to yet, we just really don't know. But what I'm asking the council is to consider allowing us to hire a replacement in his slot. I'm relatively certain that we're not going to see him back this year. I pray that we'll see him in the early parts of next. So with that, I respectfully ask the council to consider doing a future appropriations for about $35,000 to allow the police department to go ahead and hire a replacement. We're going through a selection process now that should be wrapped up by the end of the month, and we'll be in a process or in a position to be able to offer a eligibility list and make a tentative offer.
Can't even begin. recovery so he can be back here. Doing his job as soon as he can, because, I think everyone in the town wants him back here doing his job.
It's amazing with everything he's going through. His first concern every time we go in to see his house, things are going to power things back here. That's what he wants to know about.
I hate the thought of considering how it is.
And I don't even want to consider that to be a long-term at this point in time. One, I can't. I mean, he's been here as long as I've been here. So as long as. It doesn't have to necessarily. I think that's something that we're going to talk about at the commission level, about how we handle a temporary supervisor position. Should this type of thing ever happen again? So this would just create a public safety officer slot is what it would do. And then we just hire to backfill that staff. Otherwise, I'm going to blow through my overtime in just a matter of a few months. This will cover the benefits of the new officer. What's currently in the budget will take care of everything. We're sorry about that. This will cover everything for the new officer moving forward through the end of the year. And then we'll handle the next year.
Smaller or larger, I'm just
will essentially begin. So the order of barrels will be put into place and you'll start to see work. Scheduled completion date is September 5th. So it's because of the summer, it'll be done by September 5th. I know a lot of people have gotten and been excited about this project for a long time. You've already heard about the bids going out for the large money project, and the bid openings will be June 26th. So hopefully we'll start having construction on those projects sometime mid-July, late July, completions in September, October. That's pretty much the, we will be doing a project, County Road 550 South is in dire need of resurface. Jason is getting quotes now. I think the quotes he had have so far is in the $80,000 range, just a minimal resurface. So he will, we'll keep you informed. It's in the MVH budget, the regular range budget.
So just more of the park beds?
No, like west of